All right, dude and dudettes, talking the talk with the Great Southern Brain Fart here, and I have a very, very special guest, my best friend and former Heavy Metal Lunch co-host, Jaymz. So, dude, welcome to the podcast. Jammin' Jaymz. So, for anybody who doesn't know already, Jaymz and I had a podcast back probably around 2007, 2008. Was that about something right? Like that. Yeah. You know, we had a podcast called the Heavy Metal Lunch. And
Heavy Metal Lunch.
And, you know, before we even knew of a band called Mastodon, I went by Mastodon. And
you didn't know if Mastodon existed back then?
I didn't.
Oh, that's funny.
No, I just...
I did.
I just thought that, you know, I was like Mastodon. It was like dinosaur, you know.
You were a big hairy lumbering beast.
Of course, dude. That's not much different than reality, bro, you know. But so anyway, so Jaymz and I spend a lot of time every day talking about music. I mean, we literally talk every day about music, and so I figured I would just have to have him on to talk about just random bullshit. There's no script, nothing.
So when's the last time we were talking about music?
Actually, we were just talking about music probably about 10 minutes ago. And which I can't wait. I think we should just go ahead and start with this, is that I am a Kingdom Come fan. So for those of you who are old enough to remember Kingdom Come, you probably also remember them being called Kingdom Clone because they sounded just like Led Zeppelin to a T. I fucking love those first two Kingdom Come albums. You know, the debut album and Kingdom Come in Your Face, I think, is just great. I just wanted to say Kingdom Come.
Wait, it actually is called In Your Face?
Yeah, the album is called In Your Face,
oh,
man.
Lord.
It's awesome. Because it was awesome because people, you know, the DJ would be like, this is a new song from Kingdom Come, In Your Face.
Yes. We're all 12 years old.
So I was expressing my love for the first Kingdom Come record, and of course Jaymz was very like, I don't like it. Sounds like Zeppelin. So speak your part, man.
Thank you for completely doing my voice correctly. I really appreciate that.
Well, because you know, you have to start everything off with
Wait, it started because I think you had, you talk about these random bands all the time, and I'm like, sure, I'll give it a listen, because you're like, oh, dude, I love this Kingdom Come, In Your Face, it's so amazing, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, sure, I'll give it a listen. So you're going to make me a playlist.
Thank you for doing my voice.
No problem.
Oh, man.
Dude, bro. But you were going to make me a playlist, and then I guess you couldn't figure out what to put on it because you were going to put the whole first album on anyway because it's so amazing, right?
Yeah.
So, actually, do you have, like, are you friends with the guys in the band? Are they going to hear this and be like,
nah, man,
didn't like my music?
Nah, man, I don't know anybody in Kingdom Come, man. I interviewed the singer, Lenny Wolf, once. And he was a super, super, super cool guy, man. Like, I really like, you know, he was awesome to talk to. So, but, you know, I mean, that's about as far as my relationship with them goes.
Well, I didn't know, because I know you're friends with a lot of these bands, and they're, you know, because they hold up pictures of your book and all that stuff. So I was just like, well, maybe. But still, okay, so go, so I can talk trash about it. Awesome. So your idea was, okay, listen to the first album and then tell me what you think. So I listened today, and not for me, man. I don't dig it.
Well, so what was it like that you just didn't like? Because this is what I don't understand, is that I think that even though they sound like Zeppelin, like exactly, like, you know, like I'm not
that's it, they sound like Zeppelin exactly. They're trying too hard to sound like Zeppelin. It's like, if you have to purposely write a song that's as close to Kashmir as possible without getting Jimmy Page to sue you, then you have a problem, right?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, but to me, it's not any different.
I was really hoping that was going to be a cover of T-Rex. I was like, oh, they're going to do Get It On. Cool.
Oh, jeez. Thank God they didn't. But I don't know, man.
Didn't Power Station do that back in the 80s? They covered...
Oh, I thought T-Rex covered Power State. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, they told
T-Rex covered Power Station.
Dude, I love that Power Station cover that T-Rex did. It's like my buddy Chris. He always gets his ulcer flares up whenever I say, dude, I love it that Tommy Bolin did that cover of the Motley Crue song Teaser. You know, he gets super upset about that. But anyway,
yeah. Loggins and Messina covered Motley Crue as well.
No, they covered Poison, dude.
No, it was Brownsville Station that covered the Crue.
Brownsville
right.
Station that covered Crue. Yeah, I mean, they were just stupid. You know, but I don't know. Okay, so like now you have like bands like Greta Van Fleet who sound just like fucking Zeppelin, but like I don't think their songs are good. But see, I thought that with Kingdom Come, I thought their songs were actually good. Like I was like, you know, lyrically they're fun, musically I was like, yeah, it's like just a bunch of Zeppelin songs thrown together, you know. But I don't know, I thought they were just well executed, you know, fun to listen to, and you know, I mean, that's a fun record for me, man. I still listen to it, you know.
I mean, I know you do. I think you listen to it every day. That and Grim Reaper, you sort of like rotate back and forth.
I do listen to a lot of Grim Reaper, actually.
I know. But you know, it wasn't a terrible listen. It didn't like piss me off or anything. I mean, it's not like I'm some like diehard Zeppelin fan and I'm just like totally offended. I'm just like, you're trying too hard.
Right.
Like, just do what you do. Well, let the influence be there. Totally, that's awesome. But don't purposely try to clone them. Don't, like, you know, be Robert Plant. Let it come naturally. It's okay. Well, so, I mean, I thought the first six songs, you know, through Get It On were kind of... It was too far into trying to be Zeppelin. And then the last four songs... sounded more natural and they were more enjoyable.
I mean, I don't know. I think that I look at everything and listen to everything as like, do I like this right here now? Like not caring that like, oh, this sounds just like so-and-so. It's like, you know, do I enjoy listening to this? Like, is the music played well? I mean, dude, to be honest, like for anyone to say that guy sounds just like Robert Plant, dude, I'd kill for someone to say that, you know, as opposed to like, God, that guy sounds like he just ate a box of thumbtacks, you know.
I don't think your band would sound right with Robert Plant singing.
Well, dude, if I could sing like that, I wouldn't have this kind of band. <You know>? I'd form Kingdom Come too,
right.
Or Kingdom Come Again.
Kingdom Come Back, please.
Kingdom Come Twice, you know, but you know, like something like, I don't know, but. You know, so anyway, so just another bit of history too between me and Jaymz is that we always just butt heads at music.
Before you get to that,
yeah,
it's not a matter of me not like thinking, oh, it sounds like Zeppelin, therefore I don't like it. Right. It's more like this is fine, mm-hmm. but it sounds too much like Led Zeppelin. There's a difference there. You know, it's like my first reaction is, do I like it or not? It's okay. It's fine. Doesn't move me. Doesn't make me want to get up and mosh. Slam into shit. Doesn't make me want to like raise my fist and yell.
Did Led Zeppelin do any of that?
Yeah.
Led Zeppelin wanted you to mosh. Like you wanted to mosh to Led Zeppelin, really. Like
You don't mosh to Immigrant Song? You don't like fucking raise your hand up like you're holding the biggest apple in the world and scream and headbang and shit?
You like want to like get off your fucking asshole and fucking rock. You know,
like, anyway, so what were you saying about something with heavy metal lunch, right?
No, well, I mean, I think it's just so funny that, you know, for being best friends, we always give each other shit about just music in general and like what we listen to. And so, you know, Jaymz is a huge Frank Zappa fan. And like, if I turned the mic over to him, he'd talk, you know, probably about 2 hours about Zappa, which he could probably very easily do.
Yes.
I don't like Zappa, but I think it's just one of those things that's so interesting that, like, we can meet in the middle with so many things, but then just be on, like, the polar opposites on so many other things, you know?
Right.
Like, would you say that that's kind of what makes our friendship, like, even more, like, I don't know, like, almost like it would be too boring if we were just like, oh yeah, man, we like all the same bands, you know? Like, how okay is it for you to love a band that someone else just is like, nah, not really?
Well, it's, you know, it's more that I love Zappa in particular. I love his music. It means a lot to me. Mm-hmm. Like, it really moves me and inspires me. And I want you to share that same love, you know, because, like, you're my best friend, and it's like, God darn, this fucking music is fucking amazing, and I want you to see it. But you're like, he sings about juvenile stuff.
Hey, titties and, like, beer.
I don't like the crazy voices, you know, and it's just like, but to really answer the question, I think it's fine. But it's just sort of, you know, this constant going back and forth of, oh, check this band out, or check this band out. And, you know, we have stuff that we agree on. I mean, obviously, we've seen a lot of shows together. And, mm-hmm. I mean, we raged at Graveyard last year.
Yeah, two nights in a row, man.
Epic. Yeah, man. And, but then there's stuff that you are, like, really passionate about, and I'm indifferent to it, and same for me.
Yeah. Well, so, cool. Like, I love just about everything that's over the top, you know, like, you know, and for,
yes, you do.
I'm sure people listening know what that means. Like, over the top is just like, you know, it's like on 11, you know, like if
but 10. do you like The Winner Takes It All? That's what I need to know.
Oh man.
The terrible Sammy Hagar song.
That's why would you even bring that up into, like, over
because,
the top
because
shit?
You mentioned over the top, and I think of that stupid movie when Stallone turns his hat around backwards. And, like, it's a movie about arm wrestling. I mean, come
I
on.
Remember
and
that, then, dude. Doesn't he arm wrestle for a truck? Like, do you remember that? Like, wasn't it like he was like an 18 wheeler and he was like arm wrestling for a truck? Do you remember that? Like, that was just like,
God, the 80s were fucking crazy.
And, like, he won, and then he got those, like, sweet shiny looking, like, cab, you know. And I just remember thinking, like, that's a movie, you
oh
know.
My God, that's funny.
But no, I mean, but anyway, like, so, like, over the top is just, you know, just, you know, like, you know, vocals that just, like, you know.
It's because you love White Wizard. Just admit it.
Well, so to me, that was kind of what started that whole thing for me, was that, like, I never really had a way to describe, like, those kinds of bands, you know. And then White Wizard came out with the Over the Top album, which literally was over the top, you know. And I was mm-hmm. like, this is it. This is what Over the Top is. It's like.
Was that the name of the album?
Yeah.
Not just the song? Okay.
Yeah, it was also the album. But it was so just, you know, the vocals are just like, you know, like notes that are so ridiculous, like they just make you laugh, you know,
yes.
And like, you know, so like I think because growing up as a kid, you know, Grim Reaper, Venom, shit like that, like, you know, to me that was just all like completely over the top, just ridiculous. But like, I loved it, and there's a lot of bands that do that. But what was it about that music that you didn't necessarily like and that you still don't?
I don't know, subtlety.
There's nothing subtle about Grim Reaper, bro.
No, there's nothing subtle about John Leon either.
No, we will not give him any time on this show. But anyway.
Oh yeah, sorry, I can't say his name. Scratch that, delete that part.
Or for like my friend Sebastian Bach too, you know.
You need like a 7 second delay anytime I say the words John Leon.
I'm just gonna bleep it, you know.
Like, right. Beep.
But I mean,
I don't know. But I mean, you know, I appreciate Over the Top stuff more now than I did back then when I was, mm-hmm. you know, in high school. But yeah, I was more into subtlety, you know, rather than like I'd rather listen to Adrian Smith play guitar solo than listen to, I don't know, Jim Gillette.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like that shit was just like, I don't give a crap. It's boring to me.
Dude, you don't do your like metal master vocal video practices?
Well, I do. I mean, every day.
Dude, if anyone has ever seen that, the Jim Gillette, like, you know, vocal, I think, I can't remember what it was called. It was like vocal, like metal.
It was advertised in all the guitar player magazines.
Yeah, and like
guitar for the practicing musician.
And it always had a picture of him holding like a shattered champagne glass, because apparently he cracked a champagne glass with his voice. He hit a note so high or whatever.
And yes.
That's over the top. Like, but I also think that I have to go by a song by song, band by band thing, because, like, you know,
of course,
Nitro was all the suck. Like, and they were like completely over the top, you know, with like the, you know, the four necked guitar and shit, you know.
But if you live constantly over the top, there, it's like you're just out there. You're not even doing anything that's grounded. You're just high notes and playing a million miles an hour with four necks, and like, what's the point?
Yeah, I think that's why I just, like, when I'm in that mood, I can listen to a lot of it, but then, like, you know, I have to break it up with, you know, some nice psych rock or, you know, some classic metal. But man, like, all those classic new wave of British heavy metal bands, I mean, even Maiden, you know, like, I mean, seriously, Invaders, that's some over the top shit right there.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of instances on the Number of the Beast album, like the fucking video for Number of the Beast is way over the top.
Oh, totally. Yeah,
with the dancers and Satan and the person in the mask holding up the numbers, all that crap, and then at some point Godzilla comes in, you're like, what the fuck is that?
I mean, like, if you think about that whole movement, like, you had like Maiden, and you had Priest, and
Twisted Sister.
You had Grim Reaper. You had Accept. You know who else? I'm trying to think. Crocus, Saxon, like all these bands. They were just like, they just did things and had songs that were just completely over the top. There's no way to really describe it, but. You're more like me in that sense that you kind of look at a band as like, I'm going to listen to this band, not so much as a, like, I like this genre type of thing.
No, I mean, I quit giving a shit about genre back when I was in high school, you know,
yeah.
When I was 15, it didn't matter at that point, because you'd hear something that was cool. And you're like, well, that sounds like, for instance, you know, I'm sitting here listening to a ton of Maiden and Metallica and Anthrax. And then I hear Rush. I'm like, oh, this is totally different, but it's fucking badass.
Right.
And then so I can move in that direction, you know. So it doesn't matter, you know, genre. Who cares? If it's good, it rocks.
Oh.
Great songwriting, you know, it's all that matters.
You know, it's like I just had this thing about death metal where I posted something the other couple weeks ago, I guess it was, and I was like, you know, somebody, you know, give me some death metal to listen to. You're like, you know, tell me what it is you love and let me listen to it. And somebody commented back and it said, Don, we already know what your feelings are about death metal, so quit, you know, fucking around with this clickbait.
Did you do that like about 5 years ago?
I did, but like
death metal requests.
I did, but that's how I found out that I really liked Morbid Angel's Covenant album, you know, like. You know, I picked like five death metal albums, I think, and I listened to them all straight through. Yeah. And, you know, some of them, you know, I had an appreciation for them after that, you know, but some of it just didn't resonate with me. And, you know, like the Morbid Angel album I thought was really cool. But again, it was just kind of funny that, you know, people were just like, oh, we know how you feel about death metal. It's like, well, yeah, I feel that way about death metal vocals, you know, like,
because you talk shit about death metal a lot,
right? But
that's why everybody knows.
But you know what, dude, it's like, you know, I mean, you know, I hate tomatoes, but if some ends up on a pizza, I'm gonna try it, you know what I mean? And just, you know, who knows, I might like it.
Pizza,
you know. Well, yeah, too, but I don't know.
Because you're still like, it's heavy metal. I'm going to give it a shot because I love this music.
Well, the other thing, too, is that I'm also older than I was when I did that, like, say, like 5 years ago, 4 years, you know, however long ago I did it, you know. Yeah. And I don't know. I feel like I've just been exposed to so many different styles of metal and different varying degrees of heaviness and just disgusting genre tags, which that's another thing, man. Like, what happened with genre tags? Like, it used to just be what, like hard rock or metal, you know?
Right.
Like, I don't know.
But you also had like speed metal and thrash metal and black metal or death metal or whatever. You know, so you had a few, but it wasn't like it is now where it's, you know, death Viking, black thrash, folk.
Death, you know? Viking, black thrash. That's awesome.
I love that shit. It's my favorite. It's the best genre ever.
Well, but that's the thing is that, you know, with like all these genre tags and whatnot, you know, and these subgenres, it just makes me wonder why can't they just... I mean, is it just their way of keeping things spread apart, or, you know, or from getting, or from letting a certain genre get too vast to, you know, I don't know.
I mean, who puts them in that genre? Is it the band that says we're Viking Black Death Thrash, or is it a bunch of fans?
I don't know. I mean, I think sometimes it's in the hands of the PR people.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, like, you know, if I get a press release for some band and they've called it blackened death metal. Seriously, like blackened death metal. Like the
See,
first
that makes
thing
me think like Louisiana cooking, you know?
That's what I was gonna say. I just picture this like perfectly seasoned metal band, you know.
Right.
In a skillet.
Like I'm hungry.
You know? Just like, you know, eating the meat off their bones.
Well, I mean, it's lunchtime somewhere. So.
Which is pretty much every Cannibal Corpse song, you know. But
it's lunchtime in California.
Exactly. So anyway, so I put out my book this year, and I got to tell my whole story, though. But, you know, how did
my... I love the book, by the way. It's great.
Oh, well, thanks, dude. I appreciate it. Checks in the mail, dude. But, what was your introduction to metal?
It was, well, I mean, there are kind of two. I mean, obviously growing up, you heard stuff on the radio. Like the first metal song that I remember hearing that I liked was Round and Round back in '84. But it didn't make an impact on me other than, oh, I like that song because I was eight, you know?
Right.
But actually for getting into it purposes, it was Iron Maiden when I was 13.
So now you have an older brother though. Like,
yes.
How much of that did that kind of play into? Because, you know, as we talked about in my book, is that I didn't really have an older brother, but, you know, like most kids, you either have an older brother or you have a friend who has an older brother.
Well, see, I had a friend, but it was my friend, you know, it was him, a dude same age as me, you know.
Uh-huh.
My friend Brian, and he was like, and he had gotten into Maiden, and then he was responsible for getting my brother, because my parents split up and I moved to California with my dad. Mm-hmm. And so everyone else was, you know, I grew up in Texas and everybody else was there, and they sort of all of a sudden became metalheads, you know, and gotten into this stuff. And I was in California doing my own thing. And then so they're all like, hey, check this shit out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but it was, you know, and I was back for the summer, of 89. And, you know, we just were listening to Live After Death literally every day. And it clicked with me, you know. Well, it grabbed me, and that was it.
What was it about? I mean, like, why metal and say not, like, why not, I don't know, top 40 radio or, like, hip-hop or whatever? Like, what was it about metal that was like, oh, my God?
I loved the musicianship. I mean, because I was a big Journey fan. I started listening to Journey when I was 10. And, you know, it's funny, like now at the time, 3 years doesn't matter. But back then, 3 years was like a lifetime almost. And so I was big into Journey, and I loved the guitar playing and the singing and the songs and everything with that with them. Mm-hmm. And Maiden, it was just an all of metal, really, listening to Metallica or whoever.
Right.
It was that these guys are really fucking good musicians. Like, I love the guitar playing. I obviously love the bass playing. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was what inspired me to pick up the bass and become a musician. So it was just like all these things where it's like these guys are making this just like high quality music, great musicianship, and great songs.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's like it had in-depth lyrics and it had, you know, exciting music and just fantastic guitar solos. And like, everything, every layer that I could imagine of greatness was there in Iron Maiden.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's so funny because I feel like most people our age, it's like the same handful of bands. It's Maiden, it's Dio, it's Sabbath,
it's Metallica.
Metallica.
It's what Metallica used to be.
Metallica was a little later for me because I didn't really stumble on them until, you know, the Ride the Lightning album. But even then, you know, like that was a pretty extreme thing, you know, to hear. But, you know, I don't know. I just feel like that people our age had that same kind of handful of bands that was just the catalyst for us to go deeper into the genre and find other bands.
Yeah, but what I loved, I mean, back when I was a kid, I mean, besides listening to Journey, I listened to pop radio because it was, you know, the radio, and I listened to it, and so I knew all that stuff. But hearing stuff like Maiden and Metallica and Megadeth, like the songs were way more intense, and not in a sort of devil kind of a way, but like the quality of the songwriting, the shit that they were singing about, and, you know, just the seriousness of it all. It was just like, had so much more depth than pop music.
Right.
You know, than Will to Power or whatever the fuck was going on at that time.
Come on, dude. Taylor Dane, bruh.
Tell it to my heart.
See, that's the other thing, too, is that one of the things I always loved about hard rock, metal music, heavy music in general, was that it always seemed to be, at least for me, kind of a bridge to meeting, you know, some of the coolest people in my life. And, you know,
which it changed everything.
Yeah. I mean, met you, you know, you were in a different band with the same singer that I was had a band with, and, you know, she was telling me about you, and she was like, oh, he loves Iron Maiden. I'm like, oh, really? Well, tell him to hear it. Give him this, you know? It was like that.
I mean, what a great way to meet somebody. You're like, hey, I'm this folk singer. Here's this Iron Maiden bootleg.
Here's this Iron Maiden bootleg from the Killer store. You know? And it's like,
and then, like, the next week, I gave you one from, like, the what turned out to be the same tour, but I thought it was from the Number of the Beast tour because wrong information on the label.
No, wasn't it?
You still have that? No, because it was listed as like March 4th, 1982 or some bullshit, but it was actually one of those first shows that Bruce did with the band in Italy, like the sort of, you know, breaking in show.
That's, yes. I still have it.
A show from Milan, not a show from Hammersmith.
And he did all the, he did like all Deano songs, right?
Right.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. I remember. I think I still have that, actually. It's not like the greatest
great
quality.
Show. He sounds like Dio in that show. He's like really gruff and dark. I love it.
He's still smoking all that weed, man.
Jesus, come on.
But I don't know, like,
him and Davey light it up every night. Like, you know it.
Man, you know, and I think that so many people who listen to heavy music, as corny as it is, like, you always hear people talk about how, like, you know, oh, you know, metal fans, it's like, you know, we're like a family, and we're like a, you know, and I kind of believe that because there's this kind of, I don't know, like, people probably wouldn't agree, but I always kind of equated metalheads to like deadheads in the sense that, you know, metalheads are pretty much a subculture, you know, mm-hmm. or a counterculture, I should say, of, you know, we go to shows, you know, you see each other, we all hug it out, you know, we all party in the parking lot beforehand, party in the lot after, you know, like, I mean, you know, so from an audience standpoint, like, I always thought of metal fans as being this, again, like this kind of countercultural movement where,
because we had music that was like outcast music.
Yeah,
because we looked different. We had long hair and one of these black t-shirts because all of them were fucking black, and with these weird designs on them, and we listened to this satanic music.
Lay down your souls to the gods, rock and roll.
It's funny. I didn't know any Satanists back then, but everyone, you know, the image was that all of us were just like, oh, so satanic.
I didn't
so dark.
I didn't know a single Satanist, you know, like, you know.
It was so funny because my thought was just like, no, I just like the music. I don't give a fuck about Satan. Like, who cares?
I mean, my thought was that, you know, if there were people who were Satanists, they weren't the ones out there. They weren't going, you know, I'm a Satanist, right?
Right.
You know, it was like.
They probably weren't listening to Slayer. They had better shit.
No, they were like listening to like Kate Bush, you know, and she, you know.
She's totally satanic.
You know, Mantovani Orchestra, you know, stuff like that.
Jackie but, Gleason.
Mario Lanza. But. But I don't know. I mean, I just love the fact that, you know, like at least for us, like metal was what kind of brought us together and what connected us. And it connects, you know, me with so many people, and it's created such a good.
I thought it was lunch that brought us together. Like, we just loved eating.
Well, that was where the whole heavy metal lunch came from.
It was more about going and getting Chinese buffet.
Seriously, like, I mean, we used to take like the most epic, you know, like 2-hour lunches. If anyone that Jaymz works with is listening, it was actually
they don't.
It was actually 45 minutes though. But
right, it was totally 45 minutes. We would never take 2-hour lunches multiple times per week.
But you know, but and just like sit in your office with your hot pink Kramer.
And, oh yeah.
No. Oh, with the
that guitar's fucking metal.
With the Floyd Rose.
That doesn't stay in tune. Yeah. There's an ad for you.
But like that was the thing, is that, you know, so we started out just hanging out, just like eating lunch, talking about metal, and of course all we really had to talk about was, you know, the old days, you know, and you know, I didn't really have my finger on the pulse of what was really going on with modern metal, other than the fact that I just didn't like it, you know. But then, you know,
what was happening in 2006 metal wise I mean, you had the older bands making albums, but right. Like, who were the new bands?
Yeah, I mean, like, at least some, you know, some of these bands were around, I just didn't know about them, you know. And I think that's why I was so shocked when I started doing the blog, you know, in 2009, when all of a sudden, you know, I'm hearing bands, you know, like, again, like White Wizard and like Stryker and Holy Grail, and I'm going, like, these are all young bands. Like, this is crazy that they're playing this kind of music that I grew up.
When did you hear 3 Inches of Blood? Was that around the same time?
That was a little later. I think it was about, okay. Maybe it was about 2011, maybe. 2010, 2011 was when I first heard 3 Inches of Blood. And to me, I was just like, good God, that's like fucking, you know, it's like thrash metal King Diamond, you know? And yeah. I was just so much blew me away, and it just kind of opened my mind to just go, wow, like there's this, you know, we really hit a renaissance at some point with metal music. And I don't know if I would have known about it had I not done this blog. I mean, yeah. I mean, how do you think, I mean, or would we have heard of it? Would we have heard about it?
I mean, probably not. I mean, maybe. Maybe you would have heard of Mastodon eventually. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, but like, you know, I mean, would we be using, I mean, we'd probably be using Spotify, I would assume.
Probably, you know? But.
And then would we find the stuff through, I don't know, like the related artists thing? I mean, I don't know. I mean, I feel like.
I mean it's like anything where you have a meeting of something, like you meet somebody or you know, have an event and it leads to something else, and that leads to something else, and that leads to something else, and that's how you get to where you are, you know. It's just like this random series of chance, you know, like right. The Rush song goes to the chance, you know. It's like you could be, you know, it's just like this one in a million shot that all these decisions in my life led up to the point of where I met you, and then we got together and we talked about heavy metal, and then you started your blog and you started listening to other things, and you heard about Graveyard, and you heard about 3 Inches of Blood, and you heard about Just the Ancient Ones and Brave, and it's just like, oh, all this fucking awesome music.
It was like this whole other world that's out there that I just, yeah. You know, I couldn't have even imagined. But I don't know, maybe it's one of those type of things that generally, I'm not a big believer in stuff like that, but like, there's a significant amount of faith there, I think, you know, where people like you and I are such devoted music people that to find stuff like this is like we were meant to know about this stuff, because it just, at least for me, it completely reignited this passion for, and not even just heavy music, but music in general. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it wasn't fate for me. I think it was just a cool series of things that happened, you know, but I'm definitely glad it happened. I think it's been great. I mean, I never lost any sort of fire for music that I loved. It was just, there wasn't new music. There was the old shit, which I'm cool with. And there's like so much music to go explore from, you know, the past 60 plus years more, mm-hmm. you know, but to have new music is great, because it's a different sort of thing that you latch on to. Like when you're getting into a band and they've had two or three albums out, you know, right. one album, and you're like, oh, this is the band I'm gonna follow these guys, and you know, you follow their social media now, and you look at their website and watch the videos on YouTube and all this cool shit, and then it's like it means more rather than, you know, how I feel about the Beatles or Led Zeppelin or, you know, whoever from the 60s.
Right.
You know, it's great music, but, you know, it's not just the ancient ones. It's because that means more.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I totally know what that is. Okay. So we were just talking, and you said something about, like, you've mentioned Just and the Ancient Ones and Graveyard a couple times. Yeah. And obviously they do, because, you know, they're, you know, some of our favorite bands, but
yeah,
pretty different from what you and I grew up listening to. So what was it about those bands that, you know, I mean, like, what was it that appealed to you that made you kind of go like, oh, like, this band deserves my attention?
You know, songwriting. I mean, I think that's always the first thing for me is when I hear something that's just like a really good song. You know, like the first thing I heard was from you, thank you, was from Just the Ancient Ones, was Astral Sabbath. And I was, you know, I remember you're like, oh, check this out, dude. This sounds pretty cool. And I was like, you know, watching the video, I was like, oh, yeah, this is really interesting and weird and different, but it's a really good song. And it sounds like Scooby-Doo music. It's great.
Zoinks, a ghost's coming.
But it's cool because they were tapping into something that no one else was really doing, and then we saw them live open for King Diamond, and they put on such an amazing show. Mm-hmm. So all I knew from them, I'm pretty sure, was just that song. But seeing them live, I mean, they were so good, and it was really mind blowing. And then so at that point, I was like, I've got to get everything that they've ever released.
Right.
Now, today. Because, yeah, I mean, all of it is just great. Everything they've ever done has been excellent.
Yeah, it's funny because I wasn't even really, like, aware of the whole, like, occult rock kind of thing. Like, I kind of knew it was a thing, but, like, didn't really know much about it. Like,
oh, I had no idea.
You know, like, I mean, I knew that there was kind of, like, yeah, I knew there was, like, you know, obviously black metal, you know, like Venom and,
right,
you know,
right.
all those, you know, the kind of darker, satanic kind of bands. But, you know, here are these bands that were playing this kind of subtle, melodic, almost, like, it's hard to explain. Like, almost, like, sometimes it was almost, like, 60s a-go-go kind of stuff. Do you know what I mean? And, like, mm-hmm. but, like, you're listening to the lyrics, and it's, they're very, what's the word? Like, left-hand path kind of thing. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
It's definitely touches on a darker thing. But without...
It's different because so much of it wasn't, like, usually when you hear stuff like that, you know, music with those kind of lyrics, it's really fast, really heavy,
right?
You know, it's black metal, and you know, and this was like totally different, and so that's where it stands apart.
Yeah I mean, because that was the thing with these bands, was that, yeah, I think starting with Graveyard, even though Graveyard isn't a cult rock, it was that kind of music where...
Well, they mentioned Satan a few times on the first album.
Yeah, which I never really wondered. I always wondered if it was like metaphorical more than anything. I don't know, but like I just remember when I heard Graveyard, I was just like they looked exactly how they sounded, like just kind of grungy, dirty rock and roll. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. That's got like a lot of snarl and attitude to it, but you know, coming out at a time where I was pretty much just exposed to a lot of heavy metal music, you start hearing bands like Blues Pills and Graveyard and Scorpion Child, you know, which I feel like those were the bands that kind of opened that, they were that like the gateway for me to kind of go into and discover so many of these other bands that were, you know, Jess and the Ancient Ones, Lycanthropy, Children of the Sun, bands like that, you know, like it's music that I love, but it's not music that I necessarily thought I would ever hear out of new bands. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, Graveyard, I mean, like you were saying, Graveyard was first, I think.
Yeah.
Before Jess and the Ancient Ones, by, you know, a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think it was something off his Singing Blues. It was either that song or Uncomfortably Numb or something like that, mm-hmm. that you had played for me. And it was interesting, you know. And that was, Graveyard was one that took a little bit longer to really fully appreciate, you know. I mean, I think it was after Lights Out came out, maybe, or somewhere around there.
Right.
That I was like, oh, okay, this is serious shit. This is really good. And then seeing them live just blew away.
Well, that's the other thing, is that I feel like, you know, seeing live bands now, especially that play music like this kind of music, you know, it's very much a stripped down meat and potatoes kind of, you know,
it's real, dude. It's like the real deal. That's when we saw Graveyard last year. That's the thing that struck me. It was like, this is just real, honest music. There's no bullshit.
Right.
And I love seeing bands where there's no bullshit. You know, we love Kiss, but there's a lot of bullshit that Kiss does.
Right.
They have the stage and the costumes and the fire and the blood and whatever. But you have a band like Graveyard, and they do have a light show, but it's solely the music and the dudes up on stage singing and playing their asses off.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a way more moving experience.
Well, so because I always wonder about bands like the, growing up and going to shows in the 80s and stuff, seeing all these metal bands, like part of me, like I miss those like stage productions, you know, like the stairs and the ramps and the, you know, kind of like what King Diamond has hit the road with, you know, over the past, you know, few years where he made.
Well, last year's Maiden show was an amazing stage production.
It was their biggest stage production to date.
It looked wonderful. It was fantastic.
It was incredible, you know, so like, you know, and even Priest, you know, playing theaters, you know, of course it's not as elaborate as Maiden, but boy, it was great, you know, had you know, the screen behind it with all kinds of cool visuals and stuff. So it's like, I like equate that kind of performance with bands like that. So of course, sometimes when I look at a band like Graveyard or Jess and the Ancient Ones, I wonder, would that music be the same, or would it make as much of an impact on me if there was all the smoke and mirrors, even though they don't need it?
Yeah, I mean, I'd love to see them get that successful so we could see if it works, but for now, who knows?
I don't know. I got really high one night, and I was imagining,
big surprise.
Like the other three or four nights a week. But like, I had this image of Graveyard on stage with the stage production from Ozzy's Diary of a Madman tour.
Oh shit!
Do you know what I'm talking about? With like the big fucking castle looking. Like I was like, mm-hmm. that. I said that, like, Graveyard would just rock that stage setup, you know, because really, the only thing you had going there was, what, the fucking stairs that went up to the drums, you know? Like,
but I can't see those dudes running up and down the stairs.
I can't either, yeah.
I mean, they're not those type of musicians. They're not like Ozzy. Thankfully, they're not like Ozzy.
Well, you know, and that's what I wonder a lot, is that, you know, like I've talked to certain bands about stuff like this, and I remember talking to I think it was Cam Pipes from 3 Inches of Blood, and we
that
were talking
a hell of a singer.
Oh Jesus my Christ. God, man, talk about a band that should have but wasn't, man. That was just
they wrote some fantastic songs.
God, they were
I wish I could have seen them live because their songs are so good.
So much fucking fun live. But you know, like I remember talking to Cam, and I was like, you know, do you ever wish like you guys could have, or no, I remember what it was like, you know, if you guys were playing arenas, what would your stage look like? And he was just like, oh man, Jesus Christ, dude, there'd be fucking stairs and ramps, and he goes, they'd be like, you know, probably even like Dio's dragon blowing fire all over the, you know, like he had already had the image in his head. You know, you could tell.
See, that's a band that needs a dragon, like totally needs one.
But it also would have tied in more with the aesthetic of like what the band looked like, and then even some of the, you know, just the lyrical content of the songs, which again, going back to that over the top stuff, you know?
Yeah. But like, they backed it up with well-written songs and great music. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just an over-the-top gimmick with no substance underneath of it.
I mean, it was funny. It's like one of the only singers I could ever think of that sounded close to King Diamond. You know what I mean? It was this Canadian guy.
No one sounds close to King Diamond, though. That dude is out of control.
You know, that... Yeah, and that's, you know, speaking of King Diamond, you and I saw King Diamond together when he did his big comeback tour.
Yeah, with the Justin the Ancient Ones.
Justin the Ancient Ones. And, like, what was it like for you to see King Diamond for the first time?
It was wonderful. Man, it was just because I had been a fan since Conspiracy. And to see this dude, who's, in my mind, a legend. You know, and I love his music so much, and to get to see him live and have him surpass what I thought he would do, it was amazing. Great.
I mean, it's almost like that's the kind of show, you know, because I went and saw him when he came back, again, like for the Abigail thing, and it was a great show, but I almost wish that I had not seen him then, because the time before was so fucking stellar, if that makes sense, you know?
Yeah, like, I mean, it made me appreciate his music even more.
Yeah.
Which is what you always want in a live show. You want the live show to kick it, you know, to turn up to 11, right?
Oh, yeah.
So that's like what bands like King Diamond, Just the Ancient Ones, Graveyard, Maiden, all these great bands. You know, they're amazing on record, but then you see them live and it's that next level up that just floors you.
So if we hadn't stumbled upon these bands, say like, you know,
God, life would suck.
I think so too, because it's so much of what I listen to now, you know. But like, let's say like, you know, I moved here, didn't do the blog. Obviously you and I still talked every day, you know, whatever. But where would we have been musically? Like, as far, I mean, would we just be talking about the same Maiden albums
and Kingdom Come albums? Anthrax's worship music a lot more.
Dude, that was a monster record.
I know. It's fucking amazing.
To me, that was such a comeback, man. That was such a, I mean, that was, yeah. That was
yeah. So that's what we'd be talking about. We'd be talking about worship music. We'd probably be talking about Final Frontier still.
Which is still a great album, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, because I do think about this sometimes in the sense that, I mean, I feel like it's kind of like you said, like I have so much music from older bands that I grew up listening to.
Yeah.
And plus there's, you know, I mean, there's albums from these bands that I don't even know what they sound like, you know, like there's, you know, I have like what, 2 Saxon records, and there's like what, like 35, you know, like I'm sure I'd be diving into that.
Were you going to do an album by album with them at one point, or if someone was talking to you?
Yes, so somebody actually asked me if I would do an album by album challenge with Saxon, and I was like, oh, you know what, that might be kind of cool. And then I saw how many albums they had. I was like, that's way too much Saxon, man. That'd take me like a year.
You know, yeah, I was trying to convince you to do one for Queen, and you were like, nah, I don't know. 15's too many.
Good God, man. I mean, because those albums were just, yeah, there were so many, you know, just, you know, albums, which is like, kind of like what I've been having fun doing, like the track by track thing now, because I feel like,
yeah, those are great.
I feel like that's been more doable, you know, but at the same time, I feel like it also gives me a new appreciation for the albums because I'm having to listen to it.
Right.
You know, so what from back in the day do you feel like has not held up well?
My first reaction was Fish. No. Metal Wise.
Well, we know Fish didn't, but you know, hey.
You know, there was a period of time where I was like anti-Scorpions after liking them for a long time. Mm-hmm. I just thought they were too cheesy. But then I came back around and was like, oh God, these guys are so melodic. I love this shit. I mean, really, I'd probably say like Motley Crue or some bullshit like that.
Yeah, you know, what was the other one?
They have their moments, you know, but...
But I don't feel like that it's timeless, you know? Like, yeah. Who was it you and I were talking about where we were saying that... Who was it? I'm trying to remember now. Where we were like, Appetite for Destruction by Guns N' Roses.
Oh, yes. That is one that's definitely... See, it's like, I don't even care about it. That's how much I don't even think about it. But yeah, that does not stand the test of time.
I mean, yeah, because I mean, when it came out, it was so... gnarly, you know, and it was like this like seedy underbelly of heavy metal or of the, you know, Sunset Strip scene, you know, if like Poison and all them were about, you know, don't have nothing but a good time, you know, Guns N' Roses was like shooting heroin in a fucking storage room, you know, where yeah. They were rehearsed. So it's like, I remember just thinking, this is great. Like, it's so different and it's so ugly and just kind of shocking, and now I listen to it and I go, that did not hold up well at all.
No, not at all. Not at all.
Like, not even in a classic rock standpoint, you know? Like,
no, because I listen to, you'll be happy with this, I actually listened to Back in Black yesterday, which I hadn't heard in 30 years probably. Mm-hmm. Like all the way through, you right. know? And it's really solid. It's quite enjoyable. You know, I don't think it's as good as the stuff that came before it, but it's a solid album. Mm-hmm. And as far as you put it on, you know, crank it, sounds good, you have a good time, it holds up. But Appetite does not hold up.
So what do you think it was about it that didn't hold? Like,
it's just silly. Like,
yeah, so that's what I was going to say. So what is it about an album, say, like Appetite for Destruction, that doesn't sound timeless, but Back in Black, which came out, what, 7-8 years before it,
mm-hmm.
sounds as good now as the day it came out? Like, so what?
Well, I think the songwriting is better on Back in Black. I think everyone would agree with that,
mm-hmm.
right? But the sort of attitude and culture about Appetite, it doesn't matter. It's meaningless to me. Like, I don't care if someone's dancing with Mr. Brownstone.
Dude, but that old man's a mean motherfucker, that. Dude.
So you think about that in terms of that song and its impact from an emotional standpoint. And then you listen to something like Alice in Chains' Dirt, which is also about heroin. But it's just like, you get way more, there's way more emotional resonance
right.
with Alice in Chains than there's with fucking Guns N' Roses.
Right. Or hell, even Blind Melon had the song Wilt that was about heroin, you know what I mean? And like, I listen to that song and I'm like, wow, that carried a much bigger impact than, you know, We've Been Dancing with Mr. Brownstone. Like, it almost, like, it's almost he's comical.
He won't leave me alone.
That old man is a real motherfucker.
it's terrible. I don't give a shit about that band anymore. I used to really love Guns N' Roses, and now I'm just like, ugh, it don't matter.
I feel like they served a purpose in time, you know, like, but even now, yes. Like, it's so funny, because it's like they came out, and they were the antithesis of, you know, Rat, and,
the other LA band. Wasp, I'd rather listen to Rat any day.
Poison, you know, whatever, dude. I'd rather listen to Rat any fucking day. Like, matter of fact,
those dudes could fucking play and write good songs.
Dude, I will put Out of the Cellar up against Appetite for Destruction any day. Seriously.
Oh, yeah, completely.
People think that's crazy, but I'm just like, really? Can you honestly tell me that Back for More isn't a better song than Sweet Child of Mine? You know what I mean? Like, it's just so ridiculous to me. But, I mean, that's a band that's completely, I felt like, was overrated, you know?
Yes. For a band that put out, what, 4 or 5 albums? Oh, I guess they have 6. Isn't that the Chinese Democracy crap?
And they put out the Paschetti Incident.
Was that like covers? Or I never even heard it. I didn't care.
Like the Spaghetti-O Incident or something like that? Yeah.
Yes.
I think it was all covers. If it shows you how much I know, because I didn't even buy the shit. So,
did you buy Use Your Illusion when it came out?
Oh yeah,
both of them.
Yeah, I got suckered into that. You know, I remember really liking 2.
2 was the one that I bought.
That was the blue one.
Like the Midnight Madness sale.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you do that? Yeah, I did that too.
I bought both of them. I bought 1 and 2, you know.
I got 1 like somewhere after that, like maybe a year after. And then, but 1 was like not very good.
Yeah.
Had a few songs. 2 was better, but still, you know, I eventually was just like, I don't give a crap.
I don't know. I just felt like it was just so weird to go from this kind of like street, like, you're in the jungle, baby, to like, you know, November Rain. You know, I was like, I was like, so you were like a street punk and now you're rich and you can afford a baby grand piano and you want to be Elton John now? You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, I think that's what it was, that he wanted to be Elton John and he's not cool enough to be Elton John.
No, not at all. Well, what are some of the older bands that you listened to when you were younger that you've found yourself gravitating towards now that maybe you even find yourself liking a little more?
Things I like more? I don't know. I mean,
besides Kingdom Come.
Besides Kingdom, yeah, I was just the biggest fan, you know, really. I had both of their albums.
There's actually like 12.
Oh yeah, there's a lot. When I was listening on Spotify, I was like, there's a lot. I'm like, oh, they're still going.
Well, it was just Lenny Wolf. He just continued to make music there. And believe it or not, some of those albums were fantastic. He put out an album called Rendered Waters, which was fucking fantastic. But I might have to playlist that for you. See, don't you just love that we're doing a podcast and it's just like a normal phone conversation?
Right. We're just talking. Except you're asking me questions you wouldn't normally ask me.
Because I already know.
You know? Right. Well, I mean, I still listen to Maiden a lot, of course. And that never loses its significance for me. Mm-hmm. I don't listen to 80s Metallica that often, but when I do, it's still really meaningful. Mm-hmm. It still moves me. You know, listening to Master Puppets is still an amazing experience, as is something like Operation Mindcrime, you know, which we talk about Queensryche a lot in our normal lives. Mm-hmm. But I think Mindcrime is still totally fantastic.
Man, you talk about a band, though, that not only has material that stands the test of time, but that was so far ahead of their time, you know, that, mm-hmm. you know, like I remember when Rage for Order was out, they opened for Rat, which is weird, you know. Yeah, I know. It was so weird. You know, it was Biloxi, Mississippi, 1987, Mississippi Coast Coliseum. Lillian Axe played first, then Queensryche played because they were doing, they were touring for Rage for Order, and then Rat headlined. And so I remember that was really like my first exposure to them. And I remember thinking like, oh yeah, okay, so Walk in the Shadows, that's a pretty cool song. But I do.
So were they still wearing all the really weird costumes at that point?
Yeah. And like,
or had they gotten past that?
No, they were wearing the really weird costumes and like the kind of like, you know, like the half Flock of Seagulls hairdo.
Yes.
And then the drums had like the big fucking like like pipes coming out. looks like those corrugated, like, you know, drain
like
pipes.
Tubes.
All over, yeah, exactly. Like they were just like fucking like drain pipes all over his drums, you know, and like, but again, it was like I remember being young and hearing that album and not really getting it. And then by the time Mindcrime came out, I was older. And even though the concept kind of escaped me a little bit, I remember thinking like, this is very mature music, you know, compared to what other stuff I'm listening to. But like now at 46, you know, I think you and I talked about this too, is that for some reason over the last year or so, year and a half, Rage for Order just made a huge, like, just showed up on my radar larger than life again. And I started listening to it. And now it's probably like my second favorite Queensryche record.
Wow. So I guess Promised Land is your first one?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I love, you know, and that's not to take away from Mindcrime, because I think Mindcrime's absolutely brilliant, but I think it also might just be the fact that Rage for Order felt like a new record for me. Do you know what I mean? Like, I mean, I listened to Mindcrime so much that, I mean, how you and I do quote the dialogue. Yeah, I mean, like, I can quote all the dialogue in between songs, you know?
You know, of course.
Why did you do it? Ah! You know, whatever. You know, but
so fun fact: the newscast at the beginning of that album, Mindcrime, is a dude who was a newscaster in Dallas, where I grew up. So, like, hearing his voice on record was a trip because, like, he was the NBC newscaster or whatever, CBS, I don't remember. But it was like, what the hell? How did they choose that dude's voice?
Oh, that's
be the,
fucking
the news reporter on Mindcrime, sports and weather next, you know, that shit.
Well, you know, it's funny because, like, don't they have the same thing as, like, with the Motley Crue thing, the whole, like, Dr. Davis, telephone, please? Like,
I bet you that comes from, like, a sound effects CD.
That's what I was going to say. I feel like that I heard someplace that was, like, a stock.
Yeah.
Like a stock effect or something, or like a stock dialogue thing, you know, that came with
Dr. Davis, telephone, please.
Dr. Davis, telephone, please. You know, and then what was it? It's like the guy that did the intro that
Dr. J. Hamilton. Dr. J. Hamilton.
Dr. Rocker, telephone, please. Dr. Rocker, telephone.
Are you gonna have Dr. Rocker introduce this episode?
I don't know. You know what?
So, I miss him.
So Dr. Rocker was the mysterious voice that used to.
He was our announcer for Heavy Metal Lunch.
He was our announcer for Heavy Metal Lunch, and he has.
Now it's time
for the Heavy Metal Lunch. I feel like he's somewhere in Sweden right now, you know. But if I can get a hold of him, man, I'm gonna have him do the intro.
I was a retired metal doctor, I would live in Sweden.
Dude, okay, so we're already over an hour, which is awesome. So anyone who's still listening to this, you're a fucking trooper. But
good job.
But so we've talked about this too, is almost all of my current favorite bands are either Swedish or they're, you know, there's like the one or two from Finland, and then there's, you know, we got some from the UK.
You like some German stuff too, right?
Lucifer's. That's like German, Swedish. You know, I think you know that's kind of like, you know, that band is like a Heinz 57 of like all different, you know, nationalities. But
right.
But so, you know, see, I mean, all the bands I ever talk about: Graveyard, Blues Pills, Jess and the Ancient Ones,
Children of the Sun.
Children
they're
of
Swedish,
the Sun,
right?
Cadaver. Yeah, Cadaver's German. You know, Children of the Sun is Swedish, you know, so like, you know, Lycanthropy is Swedish, you know, so it's like, what is it? What are they doing right?
They're doing a lot right. I mean, I think all those Scandinavian countries are just doing it right. I'm sure a lot of it is the fact that their governments actually support the arts, where ours doesn't.
But what are they doing sonically, you know what I mean? Like, in other words,
I don't know, they're just tuned into the right shit. We should go over there and investigate and find out, be like Banger Films and go do a documentary.
Yeah.
That's how we get over there, dude.
I'm telling you, man.
That's how we convince our wives to let us go to Sweden.
Hey, we got a grant, and we're going to go over to Sweden and Finland for like 3 months, you know?
We're just gonna do a documentary.
Film a bunch of shit.
Scandinavian heavy metal, and it's going to be epic as fuck, and it'll be great. Yeah.
You know, I would love to do that, but it's like, God, like, where do you start, you know? But, like, I just think it was interesting, like, talking to someone like, you know, Jonathan from Graveyard, basically saying, like, that their big influence was, you know, Peter Green era Fleetwood Mac, who, you know, mm-hmm. you're talking was British-based. But then right. you had the kids and children of the sun, who the oldest member of the band is 21, and out of seven of them, and they... And he basically told me that what influenced their band was Jesus Christ Superstar. You know? And it's like,
wow, that's like way before their time.
Exactly, you know? And then, of course, then you have Jess and the Ancient Ones, who...
Was it the Jesus Christ Superstar with Ian Gillan?
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
the original one? Oh, mm-hmm. wow.
Yeah, it was the original one, you know, because, I mean... But, you know, so it's just interesting. You know,
that shit's like, pretty over the top. I don't know if you've listened to that.
Oh, yeah. Well, dude, anything with Ian Gillan is going to be over the top, dude, man. Yeah. You know? Like, that dude did all the cocaine. Like, all of it. he probably beat up Steven Tyler and took his, you know? Like, it just, you know. But
yeah, I was listening to Purple yesterday, and Child in Time is just... It's crazy. It's like his screams on that song are monumental. I love it.
Dude, nothing is better than... Okay, if you're listening to this, like, go to YouTube and look up Deep Purple Into the Fire live. That footage from, like, what was it? Like that classic footage from where they're playing in that television studio with all the kids sitting around. And, like... As the song progresses, whatever Ian Gillan took, it just starts to kick in. And as the song progresses, he gets progressively like more fucked up. You know? And it's just like the most...
Yeah, you can see it in his eyes and his face during that.
And it's the most amazing thing. And at one point, he like has the mic away from his mouth and he's talking. You know, like it's like we can't hear you, dude. But so yeah. So anyway, so. To circling back like a boomerang that we are, like, what is it about those bands that you think that they're doing that and say like the American bands aren't, you know? Like
I don't know. I mean, I don't know what the American bands are trying to do, because whenever I hear it, it's just not interesting to me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's either this sort of like macho persona kind of a five finger death punch thing, or it's like so image based here.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and when Ghost isn't American, they're European, right? They're Swedish.
They're Swedish, yeah.
But it's crap like that. That's where it's this. We're gonna do this big production thing, and we have to have these mullets, and they're fantastic and
fantastic mullets.
Well, that circles around in the beginning, but
that's a future band name right there.
Fantastic mullets.
Fantastic mullets.
Opening for Lillian Axe.
The Fantastic Mullets. It's like a tribute band.
Live from the Biloxi Coliseum.
Fantastic Mullets, which special guests, White Wizard. But you know, I always said that like I wanted to form a metal cover band with a bunch of people like our age, and I was gonna call it Sciatica. That'd be awesome. All our shows have to be done at like 8. catering at 3.
I gotta go home and get to bed.
Doors at 6, show starts at 7, we're done at 8. Later. All right, dude. Well, dude, this was fun, man. I'm glad we did this.
Yeah, this was great, dog.
We've been talking about doing this for a while. We're gonna have to do this again, definitely, and cover some more ground, but... I'm going to ask you some of the questions that I asked some of my, you know, some of the
cool people you talked to.
Some of the important people that I've interviewed. Because I'm curious to hear your answers for this. Okay, what is one album, hard rock and metal that everybody should own?
Tribute, Ozzy.
And why that one?
Because the guitar playing is like the Bible of heavy metal guitar playing. It's out of this world good. Randy Rhoads sounds so good on that album. He makes those Black Sabbath songs sound like he wrote them.
Oh, Jesus. Dude, that version of Children of the Grave is just disgusting, man.
Yeah.
Like, that's some over-the-top shit right there, dude.
Yeah. So there you go. Everybody, I go buy Tribute.
All right. If you could play in any band for just one night, who would it be? And I think I know this one, but...
As a bass player, I assume?
Yeah. Since you play bass, yeah.
I mean, I could go play drums for somebody. It would sound like shit, but I can do it. I would probably want to play...
Just don't play lap steel, dude.
You've heard my lap steel playing. It's god-awful.
I know.
It's like worse than my piano playing and my drumming if they had a baby.
I'd probably say Frank Zappa's band, honestly. Do what?
I'd say Frank Zappa.
Okay, that doesn't surprise me. That'd be kind of interesting.
Would you have thought I would have said Maiden?
No. I thought you were...
I would not do that. I would not do that.
No, I know. I figured you were going to say either Zappa or Crimson, you know. I think Zappa's more up your alley.
I could fit in musically with Zappa better than... Because I'm thinking in terms of like what those guys actually did. You know, John Wetton or Tony Levin in King Crimson or Steve Harris in Maiden. Like, I wouldn't do what they do as well. And I'm not saying I would do better than the dudes who played bass for Zappa, but I could live in that world, even though those guys are fucking amazing musicians, and I would have to practice my ass off for like 10 years to be able to be that good. But I could do it.
That makes sense. Yeah. Okay, so, all right, let me see. If you could have dinner with any musician, alive or dead, who would it be?
Oh, God, Bruce Dickinson.
What would you have?
No. I would just love to just have regular pub food, just like fish and chips or bangers and mash or something.
Mm-hmm.
Have some beers with him. Talk about everything. Because you know that dude has, like, infinite conversations.
God, I mean, even just that little bit of time I met him, you know, in 94 was just so...
It's funny that we both met him in 94. I mean, he was obviously on the same promotional tour.
Yeah.
But just... at different shows, and yeah, he was so freaking cool.
Like it was mesmerizing, you know. But his overall presence is very intimidating for someone.
Did you feel like a little like schoolgirl?
Oh,
you're like, oh my god, I'm meeting fucking the Bruce Dickinson. Like, this is the guy.
Well, I mean, the whole story, you know, and if you guys don't know the story, read my book. But anyway,
it's the book.
Read the book. But it was, you know, it was, I got an invitation from a friend who was a manager of a record store, and she gave me the invitation, and it was to the listening party for Balls to Picasso. And so me and my buddy go, and, you know, of course we show up, and it's a bunch of suits, you know, all kind of wander around, you know. But
what shirt were you wearing?
I was wearing the Fear of the Dark one with the really ugly, like, bat looking thing.
Oh, that bat thing.
You know what I'm talking about? So I was wearing that, and my buddy was wearing, I think he had the same one, so I wouldn't be surprised if we wore matching shirts.
Oh,
but
my God, with dorks.
I know, exactly. But, like, you know, so we're sitting at this table, you know, and we're just trying to, you know, we had gotten some, you know, well, first we were standing at this buffet and we were trying to figure out what this shit was. And Bruce Dickinson comes up behind us and he's like, that's hummus. And I'm like, okay. And so, like, I put some on my plate and took like the little pita bread wedges and went and sat at the table. And then he comes up to us. He's like, you guys don't look like you're supposed to be here, you know? And we're like, yeah, no, we got, and you know, I'm showing him, like, see, I got my invitation. I'm supposed to be here. You
know? That'd be even better if Bruce Dickinson kicked you out.
Oh, that'd be so cool. But then he was just like, you know, like, he totally, like, pulled up a chair, talked to us, you know, asked us what we thought of the Tears of the Dragon video, what we thought about the acoustic set, and you know, you're just looking at him, and like, like the inside me is like screaming and pissing all over himself, like with just excitement and joy. But like the outside me is like my mouth just kind of agape, you know, and I'm just kind of looking
at him.
So
did he do an acoustic set first?
He did an acoustic set first.
Okay.
So what they did.
Just him and Alex Dixon?
Yeah. So they played the video for Tears of the Dragon on these big screens that they had. And then they had the curtain drawn over the stage. And then when the video got done playing, the curtain opened and there was Bruce and Alex just sitting on chairs with acoustic guitars and just, they just knocked out like four or five songs, you know, and then afterwards he comes down and he's hanging out, you know. And I was just like, that was such a good, memorable moment for me. But it was also one of those moments where I'm just like, I would almost hate to meet him again and have him not be as cool as that day. Do you know?
Yeah,
what
but
I mean?
You know he would be.
Oh yeah, there's no doubt.
He's Bruce Dickinson.
Dude, I would just, you know, I'd love to tell him that I ended up liking hummus. You know, so you know.
Thank you, Bruce. Now I like hummus because of you.
Thanks, Bruce. I love hummus now. But I mean, okay. So let me see. There is a one more. Okay, if you could get back into a time machine,
mm-hmm.
and go back in time and see any band that isn't around anymore, or like a certain era of a band, like who would it be?
See, my first thought is that I would waste an entire lifetime going back to see bands. I mean, really, I would go back and see Miles and Train, you know, I would go back and see the Beatles in Hamburg. I'd go see Led Zeppelin in that show where all those kids are sitting down, or where that dude has his face knocked off.
That kid's like,
It was the 70s show, right?
It was Royal Albert Hall.
Yes, the Royal Albert Hall. God, I mean, you could literally see that kid's face melt off, which is epic.
Oh.
There are so many. I mean, I would love to go back and see the World Slavery Tour. I would love to go back and see Maiden in Ruskin Arms. Like, hell, I want to go back to like 1977 just so I can see the original version of Purgatory. But it was called Floating.
You know, or just like, I almost feel like if I could go back to like 77 or so and then just stay there for like a year, you know, but like, you know, and just discover all these other bands.
Yeah, I mean, there's so much. I mean, go see Black Sabbath when they first came to America and did 9 encores and threw their drum set at the audience, you know.
I need to validate that. I wonder if they really did do 9 encores.
Yeah, go check set list.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to check that because
he said 4, didn't he? Or how many did he say? I can't even remember.
Oh, I can't remember now. I'm gonna have to go back and watch that DVD just to see if I can find out. But no, that's interesting. Yeah, because I think about that a lot. Is that, you know, that Sabbath show in 70 in Paris, where it looks like they're playing in like a movie theater, you know? Mm-hmm. And I was just...
It's so good.
I was like, how... Ah, I mean...
Man, they were on fire for that.
Isn't that the one where they did the War Pigs that had totally different lyrics?
Yeah, because it was before Paranoid came out.
That's so what it was, yes.
It was that song, and maybe some other ones had different lyrics, but they put out like a deluxe edition of Paranoid a few years back, and that was included as one of the extra discs, so the entire show. Which, I mean, it had been available on bootleg anyway forever, but it was good to have it officially released.
Oh, yeah.
And it's so good. The band sounds incredible.
Black Sabbath!
Right.
So fucking good, dude. So.
That's what I love hearing those bands when they're young and hungry and just so on fire. You know, that's what makes it. When they're so excited to be there and they're just like gonna blow you away and they're gonna just steamroll you with how heavy and amazing they are.
I mean, especially for the time. You and I have talked about that a lot, about like, you know, what was it? Black Metal by Venom. I was like, could you imagine hearing that in 82? You know what I mean? Like, I wish that I could go back and see people's faces when they would hear this.
I would have been 6 years old. I would have been scared to death. I would have probably just like cried if I had heard Venom back in 1982.
That fucking steel saw. It just sounds so fucking crazy, man. You know? But anyway, so, dude, okay. We've hit the hour and 20-minute mark, but we got to do this again.
Oh, crap. So, that's a long one.
Thanks, awesome. Thanks for being, like, my first non-famous guest.
Hey, I'm happy to be here. This was a lot of fun, dude. I really loved it.
Oh, it was fun, man. It's like old times, man. We're definitely going to do this again. So, you know, people are going to either love us or hate us, but I don't give a fuck because this is awesome. This is
just like the old days where we had two fans listening to the podcast.
We had two fans. We had one kid that used to email us and say that she listened to us at the lunch table with her, like, friends. And then the other one was that dude that sent us all that weird MS Paint artwork,
which was just amazing and epic.
Heavy Metal Lunch, and he drew, it was like a sandwich that looked like a tank. Do you remember that? It had the olive that came on the toothpick that was shooting like lightning.
It was great.
I was like, wow. I gotta try to find that one somewhere. That'd be fucking, it's probably still up on the MySpace page.
Probably still is. The page still exists. I looked at it a year or two ago. It's still there.
That's crazy. Well, go find us on MySpace, y'all. Heavy Metal Lunch. Look us up
on MySpace.
check us out on MySpace. we'll put you in our top eight friends. You know, so
we'll move you up to one past Tom.
We'll move you up to one past Tom. Everybody's first friend online, Tom. Oh, loved it. So, all right, dude. Well, we're going to sign off. Let's do this again, though, bro.
Yeah, totally, man.
All right, everybody. This is my buddy Jaymz, man. And that was fun just talking all kinds of shit. So we're going to do this again. So, dude, thanks for doing this, bud.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Tom. Loved it.
No difference.